I think the reason Wimpy's not here is because we did our time change last weekend and you do yours next week.
Yeah, oh boy. Oh boy. Okay, what's happening, Wes? We break it down and we're following...
I don't know, Chris. How can I know? This is an arcane system. It makes no sense.
Hold on, are you serious? You don't know? Okay, we're falling back. Does that mean it gets darker earlier or lighter earlier? Damn it, just tell me which one it is.
This is too much fun.
No, come on, Wes. I've been trying to figure this out.
It's darker earlier.
Okay, thank you. Okay, I've been trying to figure this out for 2 days. So, you know, it's already, this is a problem. This is a real problem. It already gets dark way too early. And I got to be honest with you guys, I start getting sleepy as soon as it gets dark.
Oh, I know. It's like, well, 8 o'clock, I guess it's bedtime.
Yeah, it is a big problem. I screw getting lighter earlier. Screw that. I don't need it to get lighter.
Then I just feel pressure
earlier.
To wake up earlier.
Well, and sometimes, as soon as I do, actually. I usually get up around 5:30. Around 5:30 is usually when I'm up.
I don't want to get.
I like X-Metal's point here.
What is that?
Maybe JB time should just be agnostic. Make UTC the thing you've pinned to.
All the best places use UTC. We're on UTC now.
Hello, Wimpy.
Hello. Hello.
Hey, do you want?
Just been caught out by time math. I'm. Very
yes,
sorry.
we were kind of thinking that might be the case. I just wanted to do a little when we get into the show, a little Ubuntu MATE 1510 yak-a-yak, if you would, with us. I think that'd be very nice.
Well, that'd be delightful. I'll look forward to it. And okay. Yeah. And somehow I'm driving all the way to Liverpool in a couple of days' time. I mean, how did this happen?
Oh, by the way, I'm not. Who's calling shotgun? I think Mark should sit in the front and I'll sit in the back so I can write my presentation.
All time shotgun.
Sure. You can do shotgun to Laura's and then sit in the back.
No, I want to sit in the back. I want to sit in the back the whole time so that you're my chauffeur all the way to Liverpool.
I'm just going to extrapolate here. Would you like me to wear leather driving gloves and a peaked cap?
You can wear whatever the hell you like.
We're playing dress up, don't mind.
You just want to look like Miss Daisy in the back of my car, is that right?
Only on the weekends. Yeah.
All I heard was leather.
Oh, boy.
Oh, hello, Chris.
You know, I've decided I'm going to move. I got to move somewhere where it's sunny where can I go where it's sunnier right now? Where do I gotta go?
Australia.
Australia? That's what I was thinking, Australia.
It's sunny right now.
Yeah.
6 months of sun in the South Pole.
Yeah, I could do that, yeah. Then I could be more productive. That's what I was thinking. You're looking around a talk show that's ready.
It is nice, sunny, and 70 degrees out.
I gotta go.
Where are you?
I gotta go. That's ridiculous.
Looks familiar, yelling at me in IRC.
What?
I live in Texas, man, and it's sunny all day from 6 a.m. to 9 p.m.
Well, that would be 9 p.m. still, really? Because the thing is I can feel my productivity is going to start falling off.
It's time to hibernate soon.
Well, because our time zone change is going to make it darker sooner. And I just start, something with me, I think it's probably because I don't get good sleep or something. As soon as it starts getting dark or whatever, I'm an old man. As soon as it starts getting dark, I start falling asleep. I start getting tired. My energy drops way off.
Chris? It's the release of melatonin that does that.
I know, I'm 33. I know. I'm not actually that old, but I don't know what it is. It's been for the last 2 years.
33. I remember when I was 30.
Now, listen. It is so. You mock, but it is so bad. I thought there was something wrong with me.
There might be. Don't discount
it. Okay, all right. Because for the last couple of years.
When I was 33.
For the last couple of years, I was like, why am I falling asleep at like 6 o'clock, 6:30 at night? What is wrong with me? Why? And then as it started getting lighter out, I started staying up later. And then I started staying up later. And then I'm like up at 11 o'clock at night and I'm feeling just fine. In the middle of summer, I'm like, oh, because there's sunlight. And then as soon as it starts getting, so now I'm starting to get tired around 7:30 when the sun set. It is ridiculous. I've got like, so basically, I've got from 5:30, from about really 6, well really, who's going to get out of the house? So from about 7:30 a.m. to about 7 o'clock p.m., that's my window of opportunity right there to do anything. And if it doesn't get done in that time period, it's not getting done.
We need to get you some nice solar temperature
and
lights
your
rover.
The truth is I just got too much work. I need to work till 11 o'clock. That's how my life is structured. I'm like, I have a job that expects me to be available till 11, and I can't make it past 7:30. Actually, 8:30, really. Yeah. So I tell you, maybe I'll get one of those sad lights.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah. You would think being in a studio full of lights.
The ones up in a constellation or the ones attached to the side of your house?
No, like, you know, those seasonal affective disorder lights that, like, give you... I've got Hughes lights. They're, I've even...
This is not as cool as I thought.
No, in fact... In fact, one of the things that's really kind of neat with these Hughes lights is check this out. Now, Wes, tell me this doesn't actually feel a little bit different. Tell me you don't notice a little difference when I do this. I'm going to hit the button here. It's called Energize.
Ooh.
You see
suddenly
what I'm saying?
I'm awake, alert,
it does
ready
feel
for
a little,
podcast.
It does feel a little more like, look, don't you feel a little energized?
Yeah.
You do, yeah.
It's a great feeling.
I didn't hear the Energize sound.
All right, so here's the difference. All right, so here's before, right here, right? See, there's before. And here's after. Boom.
Oh, I need to.
Boom.
Now I need to open a browser.
Yeah, you do. See, because before. Yeah. See,
hang
that's.
On, hang on.
That's kind of boring, right? It's kind of sleepy.
Sad, sleepy, Chris.
Much faster.
Yeah. 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 I see.
Chris,
so.
Does that only work with a cell phone?
All right. Go on then. Go on. Do it again. Do it again.
Okay. So here's sleepy mode. This is what we're gonna start the show with. Now here is energized mode. Boom. Boom. You see that? Big difference. Big difference. It basically, and I have other modes too, like,
okay.
Here's concentrate, which I don't like as much.
Oh, that's kind of intense.
Yeah, here's sunset.
Ooh.
Yeah, now it just got warm in here, didn't
Day
it?
Day is done.
Yeah, it got warm in here. This is Greece. Oh, it's green. That's weird.
Now, where's the score?
God, I can actually see you, Chris. This is unnatural. I don't normally do that.
Sorry, there, that's better.
I think it's fixed.
Put the curtain back up. Yeah, that sounds good.
Cool.
All right.
So what does the Philips Hughes run on? Just a mobile phone app or
Well no, actually what? Actually they even have like a Python API for it. Like it pretty much anything. There's all kinds of things you can use to set it, but the consumer out of the box expectation is a mobile device.
So do you have to have firmware update your lights?
Not like the lights themselves, but the controller. Yeah.
I don't know if it was the Hughes, but I saw Matthew Garrett talking about how one of the lights he has Netcat on it. Which is
really
pretty disturbing.
I don't know about these. I mean, it does have a little controller, and it does need updates from time to time. You know, they're pretty obvious for a studio use.
Right.
Having color control over your lights is pretty obvious. I don't know.
You having to go fiddle with the gels.
You know, I was talking to Benjamin Carinthia, did I say his name? Carinthia?
Lol.
Carinthia, what is it?
Carenza.
Carenza,
Benjamin
right.
Carenza.
That's right. Benjamin Carenza, thank you. And he was talking about how you could tie in his Glucosio app, which checks for like your blood sugar levels and whatnot, with Hughes lights.
Oh, nice.
To change the light of the Hughes depending on your blood sugar. Credenza, yeah. Yeah.
We just need to record you saying it correct once, and you can just have that as a
I know!
Clip ready to go.
I've got a freaking soundboard.
And also whilst you're on form there with correct pronunciation, go on, do Antergos one just once.
Antergos.
There we go.
You gave it.
Everyone,
nice.
Creative
you
Commons, everyone. It. You can only do that on every YouTube video ever.
I've never installed GNU/Linux.
I just need to replace all these Richard Stallman clips with me saying things correctly. That's all I need to do, and that'll solve the problem. This is Linux Unplugged, episode 116 for October 27th, 2015. Welcome to Linux Unplugged, your weekly Linux talk show that's ready to head out and find the sunshine. My name is Chris.
My name is Wes.
I'm just saying I get sleepy in the fall, Wes. That's all I'm saying.
I do too. Maybe after this we'll take a nap.
Actually, you did bring us Red Bulls before the show.
I'm doing my part. I'm doing my part. We got to have a show somehow.
It's been a long time since I've had Red Bull too, so when you crack it open, it's got that distinct Red Bull smell.
Yes, it does.
But we are well caffeinated for today's episode of Linux Unplugged. We're going to get into, a few things. First of all, we're going to chat with Wimpy about some of the new things in Ubuntu MATE 15.10. I'm looking
Very
forward
exciting.
To that. Big win for the EFF that benefits Linux users. We're going to chat about that. Why Intel x86 platform is going to be just basically, we got to write it off.
We're done.
I love me some x86 CPUs. We got to write them off, you guys. You think I'm kidding? Actually, a really, really compelling report just came out on why we have to do that and why Linux users are in the best position to take advantage of that. It's from the guy who created CubeOS. And then later on after that, we're going to, right here, right now, we're going to admit Richard Stallman was right. In what may become a reoccurring segment at this point, he nailed it. RMS nailed it. This week, a judge declared that because an iOS user does not own their software, Apple can be legally compelled to unlock the device. Because... by Apple's very own EULA, that user doesn't own their device. They don't own their device. Apple owns their device, the OS that runs on their device. And so because of that, Apple has to unlock it. Wow, is that not a huge red flag and exactly what Richard Stallman warned us about and exactly something that the Linux users should be thinking about. And then after all of that, some really sleek new hardware could be coming out for Linux users. I believe now I've been working on this. I believe it's pronounced Xiaomi.
Sounds good, Chris.
Damn it, Wes. Xiaomi, and they have something really interesting up their sleeves. So before we get into all of that, let's bring in the Mumble Room. Time appropriate greetings, Mumble Room.
Good morning.
Hello. Hello. Hi. So you guys may or may not recall a couple of weeks ago, we played the Linux Foundation's The World Without Linux episode. Let's play their second one that just came out, and then we're going to play Critics. All right, so we're going to like Mystery Science Theater this thing. You ready? All right, so here it is. The World Without Linux. Woo, episode number two, by the way, with a real serious guitar intro.
All right. Road trips are the best, but I think we are totally lost.
Don't fret, dude. I brought a trusty map.
Dude.
So, a map. All I have to do is convert inches into miles and cross-reference our perceived location with the mile markers on the road and...
my bad.
Yeesh.
Sorry.
Map goes out
Don't
the window.
Don't worry. As a backup, I printed out directions.
These two aren't going to make it.
Yeah, so...
Broken up by the end of the series.
You take a left on... slight right on... right. Now,
what in the world are you saying?
Sorry, the printer cut off the directions on the side.
Ah, MapQuest. I hope you never, ever go away.
Okay, well, I think U-turn.
Wait, U-turn? I was supposed to make a U-turn?
No, U-turn.
Wait, are you saying U-turn or you should turn?
Right.
Are you saying right as correct or turn right?
Stop.
Wait, are you saying stop it or stop the car?
A world without Linux would mean a world without direction.
We are so lost. When do you think we'll get there?
All right, let's see. No, I'm gonna do this. Okay, so if a train leaves New York at 3 o'clock... Okay, wait, carry the one. You want miles, not kilometers, right? Okay, the way it looks to me, we're gonna be there by... Halloween.
A world without Linux is hard to imagine. Thanks to the hundreds of thousands of individuals and companies who support Linux, so we don't have to. Learn more and help support Linux today.
Wait, that sign says Bermuda Triangle straight ahead.
Finally, some good news.
Oh, I know, right? Sounds tropical.
Oh, hashtag World Without Linux. So what do you think, Wes? Are you impressed by the World Without Linux series so far?
There really wasn't very much of Linux in it, so I guess that's good.
You know,
Chris.
Yes. Yeah, go ahead, Bobby.
Is this a cultural difference between you guys and us, or is that just not funny in any way, shape, or form?
No, I think you're right there, Poppy.
Yeah, it's pretty much not funny, Poppy. Not only is it not funny, but I don't get the premise. Like, if she has printed out directions, what did she print them from?
Yeah.
Probably the internet. And then he references MapQuest.
Which is probably running Linux.
And I think the fundamental, and maybe I'm overthinking this, but I think the other fundamental thing is like, it sort of assumes that something wouldn't come up in its place. Like a BSD or something like that. I love the idea, though, and I love the basic idea that they're trying to convey. That's the part I should say. I love that. I love the idea they're trying to convey is Linux makes the world easier in a way you don't even realize.
Right. Spotlighting how it builds all the common infrastructure.
Do you think maybe these promotions are not aimed at us?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Exactly correct.
Do you think this is more suitable for my mum when I want to explain what Linux is and what it's done?
Yeah, yeah. I do think so. I think it's kind of fun. I'm glad they're putting it out there. And, you know, I've noticed that the first episode did get a little bit of attention.
Yeah, it did.
So...
I think if I showed this to my mum, she'd say, "That's nice, dear." And that would be it.
Yeah, there's an element of that as well.
It didn't make a big... connection to the part Linux plays, really.
No, I mean, I guess you have to...
There's a huge amount that goes into providing the real-time directions.
You kind of have to infer that Linux would be providing solutions for all those things
right,
in
but
some
if you
way.
Don't know anything
Sorry
about Linux.
Sorry to be Debbie Downer and all that, but it just seems like a complete waste of time.
The other question that has to be asked is that being created under Linux?
Yeah, right, exactly.
I don't think
it
is.
Contracted for a designer using a Mac?
Yeah. I don't know, so I'm torn on it.
Format.
Part of me really likes them getting the word out, and part of me likes the idea of sort of showing how Linux has made our modern lives easier, but part of me thinks it's a little off tone because you have to kind of know how Linux fills in the gaps in order to get it in the first place, and if you know how Linux fills in the gaps, it's not resonating with you. And number two is I probably think it was probably made on a Mac. My thoughts. Hey, you know what? Speaking of things that are probably not made on Macs, Og Camp 15 this weekend, October 31st Ooh. And November 1st in Liverpool, which is a little bit of a commute from here. Just a little bit of a commute. So I don't think I'll be making it, but I bet a few folks
got
in the
boat and everything.
I know, I could.
Float the rover.
Just put the rover on a ferry and call it good. Put some pontoons on it. What else do I need? So anybody want to chat about Og Camp and kind of tell us what to expect if people are in the area? Maybe they could make it.
Oh, yeah.
Go ahead.
Yeah. So this is, I don't know, like the seventh one. I've lost count. Something like that. And we do them every year. They're community-run events. It's an unconference. And we've moved around the country a few times. We've run them in Liverpool a few times because one of the organizers lives near there, and we've got a really great deal on a venue. It's at Liverpool John Moores University, 31st of October, 1st of November. So that's this weekend as we're recording. And people come along. It's not necessarily a Linux or open source or FOSS conference. It's free culture, open hardware, hacking. There's some Linux people there. You know,
I bet there's a fair amount of Linux people there.
Yeah, there is.
And, there's a big
but it's not distro specific. So while Ubuntu is one of the sponsors, Fedora is another sponsor, and Martin can tell you one of the other sponsors in a minute. But we have a bunch of sponsors who help fund the event. But the key thing is it's free to attend. So you can buy a ticket if you want to. If you want to pay and donate a little bit, that helps run the event, or you can just have a ticket for free.
That's a cool system.
You don't get better seating or anything like that. But the thing is, most years when we started doing this, community funded, it turns out that the community turned out to be one of the biggest sponsors, voluntarily. So people just voluntarily gave £5, £10, whatever they could, and that was comparable or higher than the corporate sponsorships we got from, like, you know, big name brands, which I thought was really nice and really shows off the way that the conference runs. And if people want to come along to Liverpool John Moores University. If you go to ogcamp.org, you'll find out all the details, the schedule. And if you've got something to talk about, bring that along and do a long form talk, or we've got lightning talks as well.
Cool. That's exactly the kind of event that I think is really in that sweet spot. So that sounds really cool. Ogcamp.org. And I'd love it if you guys showed up and told us a little bit how it went next week. So, Wimpy, you had a little deets on one of the potential sponsors here. And is this the one listed here at the bottom of the page here?
No, at the top of the page. So, Entroware, who are the platinum sponsor this year, they are also a hardware partner for Ubuntu MATE.
Right, right.
Ooh. So, Entroware is sort of the UK's answer to System 76. So, if you want a computer that is designed to run Linux, then Entroware is the place that you go. And at OgCamp this year, they're the platinum sponsor. I think the only platinum sponsor. They're going to be showing off their new Skylake-equipped systems at the event.
They've
also donated one of their new as yet unreleased models to the raffle, so there's a £600 laptop up in the raffle.
Cool.
And I can exclusively reveal that Entroware are also a Valve partner, and they will be showing off their Steam Machine at this year's Og Camp, and so you can come along and have a play with Entroware's Steam Machine. So yeah,
that's exciting.
This is great for me personally because I know these people via email and Telegram and what have you, but I've never met them in person. So this is an opportunity for me to meet the guys at Entroware for the first time. So you know, this is you know, a perfect example of what Entroware is all about. It's about bringing people together from the community to have a chat, have a meal, and have some fun, and you know, do good things.
Well, really cool. And I'm glad that they're doing that. And ogcamp.org is now, is there any chance at any point that this thing would ever be like live streamed?
We've recorded talks in the past, and in fact, we've had some people record talks and send them to us. One notable one was Stephen Fry, who sent us a talk that we played to the audience at OgCamp a few years ago, which was really nice. And he talked about software freedom and GNU and all that good stuff. We tend to not live stream because We just don't have enough people and infrastructure and stuff to do it.
You know, it'd be amazing. You know, it'd be an amazing goal. It's probably impossible, but how cool would it be for Odd Camp 16 if Jupiter Broadcasting could go and we could live stream it for you? That would be amazing.
Yeah, put that in the budget, Chris.
Yeah, wouldn't that be great? In the budget. I just got to take care of a few things. I just would love to.
That's not a bad idea, actually.
No, it's a really great idea, and I know of at least half a dozen podcasters in the UK that could help with your accommodation whilst you're over.
That'd be fun. Ooh. That would be a lot of fun. Well, let's talk more. I think that'd be really cool. All right, so Wimpy, while we're talking about Ubuntu Mate too, guess what? As the part of the big releases, all the big 15.10 releases came out, and the one that we follow really closely on the show is Ubuntu Mate Edition. 15.10 is out, and I like the press kit page that was put together, and it looks like a ton of stuff. Obviously, the really big feature is Mate Desktop 1.10. Also, the new, I know that you worked really hard on the new welcome screen. So, Wimpy, where do you want to start with some of the new stuff that's in Ubuntu Mate? Because it looks like a killer release.
Well, I think so, but then I'm biased, aren't I?
I mean, one of the reasons people might ask and wonder, why do I follow it closely on this podcast? Why don't I follow Kubuntu or Zubuntu, which has been around for longer? Because honestly, to me, you know, I feel like I've been watching a lot of different flavors for a long time, a lot of different distributions for a really, really long time. And there is really some great things you're doing here. So I think this is one of the standouts. And so that's why I like to cover here on the show. So you really, I mean, they're really, I think I'm biased as well. I think it really is a fantastic desktop for anybody that it wants to game under Linux, because the Mate desktop has very low overhead, but you're getting a very high quality, very modern looking desktop, or anybody that just wants a very simple, straightforward desktop that works the way they expect, that has low resource usage.
But still looks really good.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's friendly to use. It's very friendly to use.
So I'm biased as well.
Well, thank you very much for the kind words. That's very gracious of you. So we've got the Mate Desktop 1.10, and you touched on the Steam stuff there. So there's a couple of things where the sort of the planets have aligned there. I think Pharonix either today or yesterday published an article about, you know, the different desktop environments and their performance with running games under Linux. Mate was up there in the top couple of desktops for sort of gaming performance.
It makes sense.
And then you marry that with the Ubuntu 15.10 base, which of course has got Steam controller support out of the box. And then what we've done with Ubuntu Mate Welcome, which has got a one-click installer for Steam.
Right.
And you have an environment that can, you know, with one click be your desktop gaming environment. So, there's a few things that have sort of come together in a very sort of last-minute timely fashion. But, you know, it's nice to see all of those things being pulled together. But I suppose the Ubuntu Mate Welcome is more than people realize. I see people sort of, you know, immediately hitting close, because these sort of welcome screens traditionally have been a bit anemic, you know, just a bunch of links to websites. And Ubuntu Mate Welcome is not that. It actually does things, you know, it gives you some help through the initial post install configuration and can install. Not right now, definitely for 16.04, but now at least a good proportion of the software you would want to install on a computer. You know, if you've used a computer, regardless of operating system, you're probably familiar with things like Dropbox and Google Chrome or Spider Oak One or a whole heap of other things. And Ubuntu Mate Welcome's got one-click installers for all of those and many others besides. And we'll expand on that selection slightly. Not overly, maybe about 20 titles or so in the next release, just to sort of make that the place you can go once you've installed. And also it's asynchronous. I don't think anyone's picked up on this, but you can go down that link, that list, and hit install.
Oh, I love
that's
that.
Wonderful.
And it
thank you for
all.
That so and is so, this also sort of a is this sort of an answer to the software center that isn't a software center? It isn't an app store. It's almost something better, because it's actually more in line with what users actually need. Every single time I give someone a new Linux desktop, and it baffles me to this day the hugest concept gap that they have is how to acquire new software.
Definitely.
Because in their minds, I just Monday, I gave somebody a new Linux laptop, and his first thought was he wanted to go download Scrivener for the writing month that's coming up.
Yep.
Download. He just went to Scrivener's website and started immediately started looking for a download link and a download in EXE. And it just does not register at all how it should be done. And I think so. An app store is actually too much. It is overshoot. They have a category of applications they just want to get up and running with pretty quickly, and then they pretty much never really go back and change it again.
So right, most people, that's what they're doing. They're using the computer to use these applications.
That few functions, right? And so if you nail it with the welcome screen, you almost negate the need to have a really well robust. App store. I mean, it doesn't completely replace it, but for a good decent chunk of users, it negates the need as much.
Yeah. For a good chunk of people, it certainly fills a need, and that's what it's designed to do. So Matt Hartley actually helped with the software selection in Ubuntu Mate Welcome. So he helped identify the applications and what they were alternative or equivalent to. So some of the apps you'll find in there says, this is an alternative to. So GIMP says, and it's an alternative to Photoshop.
That's nice.
Say it's equivalent. It's an alternative to. Right. But we've done as much as we can to these applications to make them the best they can be. So in the example of GIMP, it doesn't just install GIMP. It installs GIMP and a series of plugins, including CMYK support.
Oh,
and
there's a
little bit of tweaking that goes on there. So when you choose to install Chromium, so there's a little tick box that says hide proprietary software. If you're looking at the internet section and you click that, Chrome disappears and Chromium appears in its place. When you install Chromium, it installs Chromium and all of the supported multimedia extensions for Chromium
that are
available.
Yeah,
so it does an awful lot behind the scenes, does a lot of the heavy lifting. And, it also brings some things in that probably need a bit of promoting. So things like Veracrypt, which is now the successor to TrueCrypt. Now that TrueCrypt have been through its NCC group, validations, and they've signed it off, and the guys at Veracrypt have really improved the cryptography and some of the key generation in Veracrypt. I think that is now a genuine alternative to TrueCrypt. So there's a one-click installer, for those people that have got TrueCrypt volumes that really need to stop using TrueCrypt now, there's a solution for you to import your TrueCrypt volume, bring it up to date with the latest.
Oh, love it. That's wonderful. Makes it nice and easy to move over.
Yeah, yeah. So it does a whole heap of things. And as you say, for most people, this will... So I haven't cooked this up, out of thin air. This is actually made by talking to actual people that use the distribution or use other operating systems and trying to understand what they need. And it is more geared towards people who just need a helping hand to get started. But that asynchronous technique is also convenient for someone like me, who when I install a new machine,
I can just
go down the list, install, walk away, make a cup of tea and come back and all my stuff's installed.
So that's just the welcome screen, but there's also one of the things that you I saw also updated was Mate Tweak, which I think is kind of maybe a nice point to underscore, because I don't know if people realize when they install it, you can go in here and you can actually turn on a whole bunch of more stuff and tweak a whole bunch of stuff. So not to stop the welcome screen, but I also wanted you to touch on the tweak screen or the new tweak app or the updates to the tweak app too.
Yeah. So Mate Tweak is distribution agnostic.
Right.
I forked it from Mint Desktop. So it's a utility that is shipped in Mint Desktop. I forked it from there and then stripped out all of the Mint specific stuff and then made it distribution agnostic. So it'll run on any distribution. So it's not pinned to Debian or Ubuntu. It runs on Arch just fine. And some people stuck it in the AUR. But this enables you to one-click activate Compiz, for example.
Right.
So just like Ubuntu used to do back in the day, you used to go into those extra options and turn on extra animations and Compiz would come on. There's a drop down to enable Compiz. And it's also got a facility to somewhat reproduce the look and feel of other desktop environments outside of the Linux world and within. So you've got a theme called Redmond, which looks much like Windows XP, a theme called Cupertino, which looks like Mac OS X. And then within there, I've changed the layout slightly. I've improved the way the UI works. So now there's the enable indicator, which enables the app indicator capabilities of Ubuntu underneath the hood. If
Very
you
nice.
Want app indicator support, it's a tick box away. Or the advanced menu. The advanced menu, again, is forked from the Mint utilities. That's the Mint menu, which, again, I forked and made distribution agnostic. So this is something you can install on any distribution running Mate, and it gives you that Mint desktop. And I've sort of stripped out all of the bits that are specific to Mint and made it something that you can run anywhere. And that's those two utilities are sort of those sort of value add that give sort of Ubuntu Mate some of its identity, you know, that distinguish it from the other distributions.
Right, very much so. And it makes me wonder, the next thing that comes to mind is, boy, I'd love to have somebody have all these things but not have to worry about them upgrading their distro in 9 months. Is what is the likelihood that any of this stuff ever makes it any further back down to, say, like an LTS release? Is that even possible?
Well, definitely it's going to be in 16.04.
So right. Going forward, all right. So I guess I'd have to wait. So if somebody today wanted to set up an LTS laptop, they'd kind of have to either kind of wait or go with 1510 and then update.
Well, you've got a number of options. There is an Ubuntu Mate 14.04 release, which is based on the Ubuntu LTS release strategy. Those two utilities that you're looking at there have been backported. So Ubuntu Mate Welcome and Mate Tweak have been backported to 14.04. So if you want them, they're there. Now, the thing is, I didn't appreciate this at the time, but the gap between Ubuntu Mate 14.04 and 15.10 is vast. So my advice is, if you're interested in trying out Ubuntu Mate today, install 15.10.
Okay.
Because it's the best version we've made, the most polished version we've made, and one of the other things we've worked on in this release is that you can distribution release upgrade. So I've upgraded all of my machines that I was on 15.04 to 15.10 using the internal upgrader. I worked with the Ubuntu Foundations team to make sure that stuff worked right. So if you install 15.10 today, I will personally guarantee you can upgrade to 16.04 in April.
Wow.
And Wimpy will fix it for you if it breaks.
Yeah, well, I mean, I was going to, even if you didn't mention that, I was just going to say, it seems like a pretty safe bet that since the gap between 15.10 and 16.04 is small,
you should be fine.
Yeah, it's 1-to-1. You should be able to upgrade pretty safely. So it seems like this would be the one to jump in at.
But for me, I've recently rediscovered my love affair with Bluetooth. So something the Mate team have been working on for a while now is helping the new maintainer of Blue Man, bring Blue Man 2 to fruition.
Very nice.
That's great.
Complete that.
Yes.
So Blue
Man
2 also features in 15.10, and Ubuntu Mate is not the only flavor to take advantage of Blue Man 2.
Oh, shoot.
But
also,
the underlying stack has been upgraded as well to Blues 5.35 rather than an extremely old version of Blues 4.
Right.
So consequently, I'm now able to do Bluetooth, you know, sharing over, you know, network sharing and connecting to
headsets
and speakers and stuff.
Very recently, things I've become more and more, I've wanted more and more, as I've sometimes been in the Rover without connectivity, and I just want to move a file from my phone to the desktop. And I just want to move that file between these two devices, and I just have Bluetooth as my available option.
That should be easy.
Yeah, that should be. It also feels like we are now really reaching the point where 14.04, even with its updates, even the point updates, 14.04 is beginning to feel very old. And we have a machine here in studio now that is dual booting, and one of the systems it's booting is Ubuntu 15.10. And I think I'm going to stay there for a while and go to 1604 because I don't think I can go back. Who's clicking there, Wes? Who is that? Who's click-a-licking? Who's click-a-lacking?
You see him? Swift.
All right, Swift. Maybe Swift needs to move up to the staging area for a minute. Sorry about that. So what I was just saying is I just very recently went through this debate as I was setting up this machine here in the studio, thinking, well, I might as well just stay at 1510 for a while. Just hang out there.
Check out there.
And then go to 1610.
That'd be better than this.
Generally, 1510 is a really solid release.
Yeah, that was my experience in the review testing that we did.
There's an awful lot of effort. But, you know, behind the scenes, having some involvement with some of the people at Canonical now and being able to see what goes on sort of behind the scenes on a day-to-day basis.
Yeah.
To say there's... whilst visually on the surface,
he's seen how the sausage is made.
Yeah.
And you didn't get grossed out?
I'll give you an example. If you look at it on the surface, you might not think Ubuntu Software Center has changed. But I know it has. So at the back end, Ubuntu Software Center has actually seen some bug fixing and improvements that you won't appreciate, you know, through the UI because the version number is the same. But if you go and look at the change logs, you can actually see that the Ubuntu desktop team have been working on this.
Well, that's
stuff.
A statement and right there. I haven't heard one before.
There's a whole heap of things like that that I've now got an insight to and an appreciation of.
You know,
I didn't previously have.
That has been a universal experience of mine every time we've gone in and worked with a lot of these companies that work in this field, is that there's a lot of work and things that get done that they are, A, just not very good at communicating because they don't have the time, they don't see the need, or the people who would be communicating don't see the need or aren't connected to the people making the change. Or there's legal reasons a lot of the times, too, that they can't say anything. Or, you know, there's thousands. But every time we go in there, it's like, wow, you guys are really working really hard, even though from the outside we don't see it all the time. And it's universally really much been the case, and I'm usually very impressed. So, speaking of impressed, very impressed by Ubuntu Mate 1510. I think that's becoming the default recommendation. When somebody wants to try Linux, I think this is the go-to, especially if they're coming from a Windows or Mac desktop even.
Yeah, definitely. It's just very approachable.
Yeah. I mean, unless there's a specific reason they would need GNOME 3 or Unity, it just to me seems, if there's not a specific reason for that, because even on a brand new machine, they're going to have a good performance.
Yeah, definitely. And all the apps they could want.
If Ubuntu Mate is the gateway drug for people to find Linux, I'd be perfectly happy to be that gateway distribution that people find Linux through.
There you go.
Very noble.
Well said.
If you use Ubuntu Mate and you like it, and then it whets your palate and you want to go on and find, you know, other stuff, then great. Job well done, I think, if that's the position we hold in the Ubuntu distro community.
So if you give it a try, let us know. LinuxActionShow.reddit.com and find episode 116. And I wanted to also give SciMonk2 a chance to mention about his excitement for 1604. Go ahead.
Yeah, I think I'm actually really, really excited for 1604 because I don't know if I think it was Tech Republic that posted an article, and I kind of agree with this, where 1604 is probably going to be a very exciting release because, well, specifically for Ubuntu Unity, because Unity 8 is going to come around the corner. I don't know if it's going to be 1604 or what their plans are, but I think it's going to start to pick up pace not only with Ubuntu Unity, but with other flavors. So I really think this will be one of the...
We'll see. Yeah. If 16, or is 1604 going to be relatively simple and straightforward, but yet with some nice features, and 1610 is going to blow your freaking mind.
Yeah, probably something around there, within the next couple of years, I think it'll drastically change.
Stay tuned and find out. I love it.
Keep watching this show.
Okay, so we have a big win for Linux users to get into. We still have the Intel discussion to talk about. Also, we have to discuss this. You don't own your operating system, therefore it can be decrypted, and the new Linux laptop. And we have some emails to get into. So I'm going to take a second here. I'm going to tell you all about Linux Academy. Yeah, I want to talk to you about Linux Academy right now. Go to linuxacademy.com/unplugged to get our special Linux Unplugged discount. And then give a tour, if you will, of their different features. I think you'll be pretty impressed. It's Linux users that got together with developers and teachers to make something really great. And it's not, here's what I love about Linux Academy, is it's not just an attempt at covering Linux and open source stuff. It is truly what they are passionate about. They have step-by-step video courses, comprehensive study guides, and the courses as well have come with instructor help, so you're not on your own necessarily. You can contact a real human being instructor and get help. There's a great community stacked full of Jupyter Broadcasting members. The courses come with their own lab servers, 7+ Linux distributions you get to choose from, because they get that there's different distros you might need to learn on. You can keep track of your progress as you go, and they've been rolling out brand new features. Rather than just checking solutions, you'll now get instant feedback. So you don't have to just try something, submit it, and see how it does and get scored. You can get immediate feedback when performing exercises. And then you can know if you need to make a change to do it correctly. There's a new learning tool that's part of Linux Academy membership at no additional cost that really adds some nice functionality. Like, they're applying this new tool to build performance-based practice exams for certs, such as the RHCSA and the Linux Foundation Search. Now, those Red Hat certifications are a serious thing that people really get stressed out about.
And spend a lot of time and effort trying to get.
Yeah, so the fact that they're building this performance-based practice exam, I think, is really slick, really well done. And it's for, finally, for people that are Linux users that have certain high expectations of what is being taught to them, and not just like this basic stuff that's coming from somebody who's just doing, you know, a professional read, but actually somebody who sat down and wrote the material, instructors that are familiar with it when you need help, scenario-based labs, so you actually work with this stuff in a production live environment, a real lab server where you can SSH into and do the actual work. I think it's really nice. And they have also launched their professional development certification platform. It's a new set of tests that are very targeted and a lot different than professional certifications. So there's a lot of new ways to challenge yourself. There's also tools available when you have limited availability that automatically adjust the courseware to match your availability. You combine that with the video streams. It's really pretty neat. And then, last but not least, you can deep dive into single topics with their nuggets. You go there 2 to 60 minutes long, learn something really simple, like how to use IP tables, how to use rsync, how to use Samba, how to set up Samba for this or that, just really specific topics. And it's really nice because they're all really quick, or at least very specific. And I really think you should check out their lab systems. It's really cool. The fact that it comes with the lab is a nice feature too, because if you're doing some of the AWS courses, you don't have to worry about setting up all that stuff. They'll take care of all of that for you as part of the integrated lab platform. It's really cool.
No surprise AWS bills. That's a big thing.
Yeah, that has bit me. LinuxAcademy.com/unplugged. Go check them out. And a big thank you, Linux Academy, for sponsoring the Unplugged program. You guys are rocking. And that new October update is huge. Huge. If you sign up, you can go read more about it and go check out their community section as well. It's very nice. LinuxAcademy.com/unplugged. Thanks, Linux Academy. All right. So BRTMR wrote into the show. He says, I was not satisfied with podcatchers for the command line, so I built my own. And it's called PodFox. Now, I don't know how do you catch your podcast right now, Wes? How do you catch your podcast? How many podcasts you subscribe to, Wes?
Oh, maybe on the order of 10. 10
okay,
to,
yeah,
10 to 12.
Yeah, that's actually almost exactly where I'm at.
Yeah.
How do you download them?
Are you familiar with Curl?
Are you serious?
Well, no, actually, I use Aria 2, oh. But it is in the terminal. That's usually how it goes for me.
Really?
Yes.
Okay, so this might be perfect for you. So PodFox is a podcatcher for the terminal.
I'm loving this logo here.
Yeah,
it's
that is good, right? That is good. It's a work in progress, but it has got a nice, simple directory structure. Every podcast identified with its own short name. And I think you were checking this out a little bit ago. What do you think about something like this? You're doing a dozen shows manually?
That does sound crazy now that I think about it. But yeah, that's what I have been
doing.
Have
you tried BashPod or two?
I have not, actually, no.
Okay, okay.
So maybe I should give PodFox a shot here.
Wow.
I like Python. It looks neatly implemented.
I thought for sure your answer was going to be on your phone.
Oh, yeah? Well, actually, no, I do it the reverse. I usually download it on my computer and stick it in my sync thing folder, and then it syncs to my phone.
So tell me, IRC, how do you, IRC Room, what do you use? Like, what's the app name or the tool you use to download your podcast? And then Mumble Room, I'm curious, is anybody in the Mumble Room also using the command line right now to download your podcast?
Stay with me, brothers.
You used to, Popey? What do you use? Okay, how did you do it? What do you use now?
There was a tool called HPodder.
Oh, yes. HPodder was good.
Written in Haskell, mm-hmm. I think, mm-hmm. which is why it's called HPodder. I used to use that. But now, actually, I have an iPad 1 that is pretty much useless for anything because no apps work on it anymore and there's no software updates.
Right.
So I just have it sat there with the Apple podcast app running and it downloads my podcast from iTunes and I sit and listen. And that's the only thing it does.
I guess it has a decent enough speaker, too, right? So...
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
That's not too bad. Yeah, okay. So sort of a mobile setup there.
Do you see they have a tech snap as one of the example URLs here?
No, I didn't see that. Are you serious?
It looks like it.
That's really funny. Where do I go to see that? Go down to import and then, yeah, you're right. The TechSnap MP3 feed. I love them already. Well, I'm glad I came across them. That's funny. No, I was just checking this out. Oh, well, he did submit it to the Linux Action Show subreddit, so that makes sense.
That makes sense.
That does make sense. The TechSnap MP3 feed, that's a popular feed.
Yeah, that's some great stuff there.
That's a good commuter show. I got to say, if you haven't listened to the TechSnap show, you throw that. I mean, you could look at Alan Jude's face if you want, but it
works for me, it's his voice. It keeps me calm when you're sitting in traffic.
Right? Especially when he's talking about ZFS.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Which is a lot. All right. So anyways, moving on. YouTube. I'm seeing a YouTube DL. What are podcasts? That looks familiar. Somebody kick him out of here. Rekai says he streams all on YouTube. Beyond Pod on Android. Hmm. Anybody else in the Mumble Room have a shout out for the podcatching software they use?
Pocket Casts.
Yeah, Pocket Casts is one of my favorites. I totally agree. Oh yeah, Wimpy, that's what you use for the 20 podcasts you subscribe to.
Yep, Pocket Casts, and occasionally I send those via Chromecast, but almost exclusively through Pocket Casts.
Yeah, and on the internet phones, the Overcast from the Marco Arment is really good. It's free now, and one of the nice things, this is if you get and the Pocket Cast does this too. If you get a podcast player for your phone, it's really nice to have it sync with a web player.
Oh, yeah.
Because if I've been driving and the podcast gets really interesting and I park, I oftentimes want to go in and finish it on my computer speakers, which are usually pretty nice, and listen to the podcast there. So to have the podcast mobile app sync with the web app is really nice.
Ooh, that sounds like a feature I would like.
Yeah, it is. So you should check out Pocket Cast or Overcast if you want to get an internet phone. Yeah. So there you go. apparently we woke up Alan. Now Alan's in the chat room. Sorry, Alan. We love you. Everybody say TechSnap is awesome. And ZFS rocks in the chat room. All right. So you can go check it out. So moving on from there, Wes, you caught this one today. This came out today as we're recording. It is a release or a media alert.
Media alert.
Hold on. We should do this legit style. Do you want to do this legit style?
Let's do it.
All right. Here we go. It's a media alert, everybody.
CNN breaking news.
All right, from the Electronic Frontier Foundation, a media alert is coming in here that is actually a pretty big deal. It's actually good news because I started the day with bad news because CISA is raging through the U.S. right now, and net neutrality just got a piss in the EU. So I was like, I was just nothing but bad news this morning. But today, the EFF made a post that says, Librarian of Congress has granted security researchers and others the right to inspect and modify the software in their cars and other vehicles, despite protests from vehicle manufacturers.
They would protest.
Well, this has become a big deal that those of us who have grumbled about the proprietary software in our cars have been talking about for a while, but really came to light with the Volkswagen stuff. So the fact that this Volkswagen scandal with the cover-ups and is really sort of forced this issue through, I think. And this is a big, big win for the end user. They say this access control rule is supposed to this is what the manufacturer were using to block access. They say this access control rule is supposed to protect against harmful and unlawful copying, said the EFF staff attorney. But as we've seen in recent Volkswagen scandal, where VW was caught manipulating some tests, it can be used instead to hide wrongdoing hidden in computer code. The EFF also won an exemption for users who want to play video games after the publisher cuts off support.
Yeah.
For example, some players may need to modify an old video game so it doesn't... some players may need to modify... Oh, yeah, because this is what you're not getting in trouble for now. Some players may need to modify an old video game so it doesn't perform a check with the authentication server that has been shut down. The librarian also granted the EFF's petition to renew previous exemption to jailbreak smartphones and extend that to other mobile devices, including tablets and smartwatches.
It's really upsetting to me that we have to get this as an exception that's occasionally granted by the Librarian of Congress, but I'm still very glad that it's continuing to be the case. It's like a subtle win for a digital ownership that we kind of subscribe to.
Yeah, it's like a continued win of something we should already just have.
Yes, exactly. That should be enshrined and we shouldn't have to get it renewed every so often.
Yeah.
But thank you, EFF.
Yeah, I guess what this really is it's sort of working around the rules that the proprietary software vendors try to put in there, which we are going to be talking more about in a moment. So let's not go too far down there. While we're in the things that Wes came across that made us scratch our head this week category, because I think you also sent this in this morning when we were chatting. This is a real interesting piece on the invisiblethings.org blog, which is also where you would find Cubes OS. And I'm just going to read it to you, and then we'll see what to make of it. So today I'm releasing this first paper. Finally, you can see the PDF or EPUB here. As mentioned, this paper is mostly a survey of the various problems and attacks presented against the x86 platform over the last 10 years. And boy, is it. It is a litany list of issues with x86 that basically, to me, look like it condemned the platform because there's so many different vulnerabilities built in. They start with the BIOS, the root trust of everything, bad SIM, SSMs. Then they go on to talk about UEFI. They talk about some of the stuff Intel's built in for management. And then from there, it's networking devices, of course, USB devices, the graphics subsystem, disk controllers, audio cards, microphone speakers, cameras, embedded controllers, Intel management engines. The bottom line is specifically Intel x86-based machines are just extremely, extremely vulnerable. No ways about it. Is that essentially what you grokked from it too?
Yes. I mean, I think a lot of what they're talking about as well is just the amount, you know, the instruction architecture is not necessarily bad. I mean, it might be old and crufty now. People have different opinions on that. But
yes,
the amount of microcode and other things that runs without the running operating system's knowledge or intervention in any way,
right,
has made it so that efforts, you know, from the open source community to make secure kernels that are running on, you know, verified hardware, you can never trust it now. You know, it's similar to what we see in cell phones.
Yeah, it's very much like that baseband that has its own.
They can reach right into memory and, you know, stops the regular processor in its tracks.
So we'll just roll with the theory here that x86 is a very vulnerable platform. You know who I wouldn't want to necessarily be right now? I wouldn't want to be Windows. That's because they're really, really tied to this. I feel like this is something that Linux is going to be much better at rolling with if, I don't know what we'd roll to, but let's just, you know, we're just going with this theory here. If this is really a big deal, it seems like this would be something much quicker for Linux to respond to than it would be for Windows or Apple to respond
to. Right, assuming that, you know, we could get the headwind to change major architecture that is used by, you know, the computing public.
Yeah.
I think you're right.
Yeah. What do you think, Wimpy? Is it possible? Is it all in the hands of the distros, or could it just be a maybe one big distro comes out and says, "All right, we're releasing for this laptop," and they, you know, who knows how it could happen? There could be something there. But what are your thoughts?
Well, all the big distributions are making their platforms available for other architectures. But when you look at DistroWatch, there's 800-some Linux distributions almost exclusively aimed at, you know, PC, the Intel chipset. Of those, there's about 20 or so that are aimed at ARM platforms. And if you're a distribution maintainer, it's very difficult for you to differentiate yourself from everybody else if you've got eight other distributions to, you know, compete against, in air quotes. But if there's only 20 distributions on ARM, for example, or half that on PowerPC, and PowerPC is still a thing, you know, people think of the old PowerPC on the G4s, but you can buy, you know, new PowerPC based equipment. You know, there's the Amiga One, X1000, X5000, and X500 devices. Then, you know, if you're building for those architectures, then you're also, you know, just hedging your bets for the future, because the trend is ARM is becoming the consumer chip platform. And, you know, you still want a foot in the Intel camp for serious gaming and professional workstations. You can't ignore that. And obviously, at the moment, despite the energy efficiency of ARM, you want Intel in the data center. But you, as a distribution maintainer, you can't not be looking at those alternate architectures.
I do agree to an extent. It's an interesting thought that you put forward, is that ARM is going to become the consumer platform. And kind of the concession that you're making there when you say that is consumers don't need a lot of CPU power.
Well, they need some hardware acceleration for things for media consumption, and they need some degree of 3D performance for casual gaming. And it's only when you get into the serious gaming arena and professional workstations that you actually need to step out of the ARM arena where that isn't yet, and it could well be. I mean,
I think it will. I think you look at some of the latest generation of CPUs and GPUs coming out for ARM, and it's...
I have to say, I think most of the ARM stuff is driven by economy at the moment rather than, you know, technology, and I think ARM is far more capable than people are paying for. So I think it could well be, you know, the next platform. You know, I really do think it's a contender. But, you know, we should be gearing up, you know, our distributions to support these platforms. So just thinking, you know, if you're being myopic and saying, oh, well, I'm laser focused on Intel 64-bit.
Right.
Well, I tell you what, you're missing a trick there. There's, what is it, that I think in February, the Raspberry Pi Foundation said they'd sold 5 million Raspberry Pis in 2 years. You know, if you extrapolate the numbers out, they must be clearing 6 million, approaching 7 million by now. Right now, there are two Linux desktop operating systems, soon to be a third in the guise of Ubuntu, desktop operating systems available for the Raspberry Pi 2. So do you want to be competing against 800 distributions on Intel, or do you want to be one of the three with 7 million devices? You need to be gearing up to ARM, and like I say, PowerPC isn't dead. PowerPC is massive in the data center. This is what's driving these new IBM mainframes.
Yeah, that actually all rings pretty true.
Let's be clear, they're not PowerPC, they're power.
Well, it's, yeah, the architecture is obviously, it's the lineage, yeah.
And also, there is still a pretty healthy...
Which, by the way, has very similar problems to the x86.
There's still also, I mean, a crap ton of literally PowerPC desktop machines on eBay. There's still a crap ton of those things getting sold. So I don't know if we could really walk away from this conversation without admitting that ARM probably is riddled with its own issues, too. It's not like ARM is some sort of savior platform that doesn't have security vulnerabilities, and not to mention it's always going to come down to implementation.
And you have to trust the whoever's manufacturing them anyway.
Right, yeah. And when you have physical access to a device, it doesn't matter what the CPU architecture is, there's going to be vulnerabilities. Because all these ARM chips, all these ARM systems also have USB buses, so those is there the same vulnerability there? But I think all the underlying points that Wimpy just made and the point that I'm trying to make too is that Linux is specifically at a just technical advantage to roll with this. I think Wimpy underscores a good point though, that really just out of the box, good to go consumer focused distros that anybody could use, we're really lacking that right now. And I hadn't really thought about it because when I think about it, I think of Raspbian and I think of Arch, and that's what I run on the Raspberry Pis. I don't really think about
it. And unless you're up to speed with Arch, you've got to augment that into a desktop distribution. Right now, you've got Raspbian, Ubuntu Mate, and soon Lubuntu. And then you've got, you know, things like RISC-OS, and you've got other distributions. There are other distributions out there, but they're not desktop-focused, you know, end-user-focused. And whilst the Raspberry Pi 2 is just about capable of being a desktop replacement, it's not about what's there now. For example, Odroid, if you buy an Odroid and an eMMC chip with Ubuntu pre-installed as your Linux distribution rather than Android, when you plug that in and boot it, it's Ubuntu with the Mate desktop. Now, it's not Ubuntu Mate, but it is Ubuntu and the Mate desktop. And they've got the fortunate position that their GPU has also got open source drivers, so you've got all of that 3D stuff all accelerated out of the box. And Raspberry Pi is very, very close to, you know, delivering their accelerated drivers for X. So I think Linux 4.4 is targeted for the initial version that doesn't have all of the 3D acceleration yet, but, you know, it's coming. So this is why I've ported every Ubuntu flavor to the Raspberry Pi 2, because when that driver is available, every Ubuntu version is ready to go.
I agree with you. When the horsepower gets there, I think you could see there's machines here in the studio I could even see replacing it to a certain degree. So,
and it seems like we're only on the start of that. You know, like the desktop computer revolution really had gave Intel the funds to work on their fabrication technique.
That's true.
That's what we're going to see now in the ARM.
Yeah,
fabs,
the phones are definitely, they're really adding a lot of fuel to that development fire.
Apple pays all that money to get those A9s manufactured.
Yeah, yeah.
That investment gets
and Samsung
out.
Samsung is building a lot of those, so that's not all lost. Even when they're building the Apple chips, they can't all be lost R&D. They have that machinery, right? They have all. I don't know. They
learn from this,
right? Exactly. And so I would say for me, it's nowhere near ready. Nowhere near. I just can't even see it for years for me. But I could see it for my kids already, and I could see it for a lot of people in a lot of different work roles very soon, if not already. So it's very cool. All right, so I want to move on from this, and I want to discuss this EULA situation that is very uncomfortable because it's a bad precedent, and I think it's one that might be a good talking point for us that are discussing with users. Why would you want to maybe use Linux over Windows 10? Why would you want to maybe use the Ubuntu phone over Android or something like that? Well, this might be the number one talking point from here on out, I would think. But first, I want to tell you about our friends at DigitalOcean. That's where I have my servers. Back in the day, before DigitalOcean, I was all about Proxmox. I was all about Proxmox. If I needed a server, I'd spin up a Proxmox VM. Have you ever messed with Proxmox?
Only a little bit.
Yeah,
but I've heard some good things.
And
from,
you probably messed with VirtualBox.
Maybe you. Oh yeah, definitely.
Yeah. That's so, you know, like, okay, so what would I would go get like my best Core i7 PC, and I'd put a bunch of RAM in it and a bunch of hard drives in it of various quality. And I would put that in my garage, and that would be how I would do my virtualization.
Like a Frankenstein monster.
Yeah, and that worked for basically always about a year before, for some reason, it completely blew up. And now I'm like big time. Now I'm like, I walk in, I'm like a boss. I'm like, yeah, I have infrastructure in the cloud. I have data centers in New York, San Francisco, Singapore, Amsterdam, London, Germany, and I got an API. Got a new one up in Toronto. Yeah, I got it. It's straightforward, that API. One-click deployment of things like GitLab, Docker, one of the first to deploy Docker.
Yeah. Wow, Chris, I'm impressed.
My data center is DigitalOcean. Yeah, I know. It's a big surprise. DigitalOcean, if you use the promo code DO1PLUG, you can get a $10 credit, and you can try out DigitalOcean 2 months for free. The $5 rigs, Wes, I'm telling you, I think just about every time you come in here, you sit down and log into a droplet in some form or another.
Yeah, that's pretty much
true. Is that Quasal, a core there running off of?
It sure is.
Attaboy, Wes. Yeah, I got my Quasal core running off of DigitalOcean droplet too. Seriously, if you use IRC for work or for communications, you should be looking at Quasal and Quasal core and put Quasal core on DigitalOcean droplet. Worth $5 right there.
Oh, yeah, and it's real easy to get set up.
It is.
It just always runs. Yeah, it's just right there for
trust
you.
Me, it is. It makes, it, you know, what you'll do if you do that is you'll be like, why did we ever use anything but IRC? Yep. Why is Twitter a thing? Why is Slack a thing? Why are we even using email? Really? Why are we not using IRC for all the things? Anyways, there's a lot of different things like sync thing, own cloud, like I mentioned earlier, GitLab, BitTorrent sync. We do a big distribution for BitTorrent sync for our Unfilter show. Lots of people sync from that, all powered by DigitalOcean droplets. It's really a cool system. And one of the really nice things, if you need like a back-end storage rig, there is some really cool solutions when you use private networking with DigitalOcean. The data sent between machines on the private networking doesn't go against your transfer. Even though you get a terabyte of transfer, you can use private networking to do like back-end caching, proxying, or a back-end file server. And they have a really good interface to manage all of this. So for $5 a month, you can get 512 megabytes of RAM, a 20 gigabyte SSD, one CPU, and a terabyte of transfer. DigitalOcean is nuts, son. They're crazy. I want you to go check them out. And they now also have floating IPs. So that way when you go big, when you're Ubuntu Mate and you're like you're going big, you know, or
big.
Yeah, you want to, or you know, you want to be fancy and you want to have a big launch day, they got floating IPs.
You can scale out however you need.
Just move it around. Just move it. Floats. It floats.
That's fancy.
You know what? Things in the cloud float.
Yeah.
What I like about DigitalOcean too, it's all running on top of Linux. They use KVM as the virtualization platform, which some other providers out there that you may have heard of before are kind of kicking themselves for.
No kidding.
They're kind of like, I wish I would have gone KVM.
The best thing about KVM, you get your own kernel right there, you know?
Mm-hmm.
You get all the new fancy kernel features. You want C groups, you want IP tables, like whatever you want. Yeah. It's right there.
And that means they're able to roll out the newer distros way before other guys are too, which is really cool. DigitalOcean.com, use the promo code DOUNPLUG to support the show and get a $10 credit. And a big thanks to DigitalOcean for sponsoring Linux Unplugged. You guys rock. All right, so just let's talk about this from a general Linux perspective. The DOJ dismisses Apple's argument against encrypting iOS. And to Apple's credit, they have been fighting this case trying to say that they you know, it'll do them harm if they have to unlock it. They say they can't unlock anything iOS 8 or above. However, the federal court is not agreeing. The U.S. government rejected Apple's argument in federal court that unlocking iOS devices for police would damage the tech giant's public image because they've done it before. Boom. Apple designed, manufactured, and sold the phone that is subject to the search warrant, the government told U.S. Magistrate Judge James. But this is only the beginning of Apple's relationship to the phone and this matter. Apple wrote, Apple owns the software and runs the phone, their argument is. And the software is thwarting the execution of the warrant. The software is thwarting the execution of the warrant. In the Justice Department's filing in the case involving the iPhone discovered on a suspect, he's indicted for a for a drug possession, meth. And this is an ongoing battle. Apple filed a brief saying, in most cases now and in the future, it would be impossible for it to extract encrypted data from an iOS device. But they dismissed the argument, says Apple's asserts it's Apple's burden is not provable since they've done this before. And they also moving ahead here, they say Apple should be able to unlock it. The government's argument is essentially that Apple has never really objected to this case, and the fact that they have set up guidelines by which they'll comply doesn't stop them from objecting in a particular case, but they have the ability to do it here, and that clearly the judge was concerned. Apple also warned that if we're forced to routinely decrypt data for law enforcement, its employees could theoretically be subpoenaed in every case to provide expert testimony. They cited a previous case where an actual employee who did the decrypting ended up getting hauled into court because he then saw the evidence. So just the technician that had to do the decrypting.
Wow.
Yeah. So this is, there's several things Apple's trying to fight against. Having to do future decrypting, having to bring its employees into court if they do the decrypting, and now this argument that Apple software licensing agreement specifies that iOS software is licensed, not sold, quote unquote, and that users are merely granted a, quote, limited non-exclusive license to use the iOS software. So in their argument, because it's the software preventing the decryption and Apple owns the software, not the user, Apple must decrypt it because the users don't own the software.
Yeah, I like how they came back and said that, you know, well, you guys have been claiming for so long now that it's your software, that you're mm-hmm. just licensing it, so
proprietary,
you can't have both sides of it.
Is not ethical.
Yeah, you know what? You know what else makes me think of?
Malicious functionality,
mm-hmm.
perverting free software.
That program, although it may be attractive, is really a trap.
I think all of those old. All of those statements are correct.
Yep.
All of those statements, he's right. RMS is right. This blows my mind. That their argument is literally that because you don't own the software, you license the software, the manufacturer should be able to decrypt it. And they might actually get this. They might actually win on that argument. They might actually be able to convince the judge of that.
Maybe Apple will take their security claim seriously enough and change their licensing agreement. Probably not, though.
That would be, I guess, the best direct fix, right?
Right. I mean, they've already got the encryption going on, you know, 8 and 9, but...
But doesn't this seem like the biggest argument, like, out of all of the arguments... I mean, doesn't this really fundamentally prove why it's important to own your own software?
Yes, I think so.
Like, this is, like, to me, seems like the biggest bullet point for that. There was a post that I caught recently titled, Richard Stallman is the Hero the Internet Needs, and a few bullet points. He warned of the growing danger of DRM in the great story, The Right to Read, in 1997. He warned about DRM in 97. He refuses to own a cell phone on the grounds that it might be used as a tracking or covert listening device. Slightly paranoid, but looks increasingly possible. Stallman considers cloud computing. Yeah. Stallman considers cloud computing dangerous. In 2008, he thought this would sound like an alarmist. Now nobody trusts the cloud. He always held the proprietary software could not be trusted. Windows 10's shady behavior proves that point.
You mean the Windows 10 I'm running here in the studio,
mm-hmm.
Chris?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But he was right. He has been right.
Yeah, he's been consistently on the ball there.
Yeah. So I don't know. Does anybody in the Mumble Room have thoughts on the EULAs and not owning the software and the ramifications that maybe we're just now beginning to understand?
I'm still reading the Windows software.
Go ahead, North Ranger.
Well, if the idea behind copyright is for the benefit of the public to secure for authors a limited time, there's really no limits at this point as far as the government's concerned.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, that's a good point. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Now I know two other people. Who else wanted to speak up? I caught, next, go ahead and whoever goes first can have it. That's not a very good system, is it?
Nope, free for all.
All right.
This is Unplugged, after all.
Yeah.
Go ahead. Sean Casey, let Sean go first.
All right, Sean, go ahead.
I was just saying, like, given the fact that basically all software is licensed, do we really own any of it?
Yeah, I guess you'd have to look into the individual EULAs for open source software, but I think if you have the code and you can modify it, functionally you own it.
Right. It's at least closer to our pre-software definition of ownership than what you get with a Apple or Windows-style license.
And Casey, you were next? Or was it Sean that was next? Sorry, I can't see your names, guys. The screen's too small for me. I'm an old man now.
No, it was me, WW.
Oh, okay.
Actually, ahead, the EULA for Windows 10, I plan on going over with him and looking at it. It's pretty horrendous when you see that, we can use subject and the body of your email to just return user input. It's really bad.
Yeah, that is a particular nasty one. And Heavens, you want to get a chance to jump in, too. Go ahead. Oh, we can't hear you. Wow.
While he's getting his mic fixed, I would say in the future, I look forward to the day when the DOJ hauls Richard Stallman into court and says that he has to speak for the fact that he created the license and all the stuff on my machine is licensed under GPL. Yeah. And so he's responsible for the software that's on my machine.
There you go. There you go. That's a good twist. I like that. Heavens, one more chance. Did you get your mic working? Going once? Going twice? I wonder what happened over there. What happened over there? Maybe Pulse Audio. That's what everybody always goes to, right? Everybody always has to blame Pulse Audio. All right. Well, Heavens, I'll give you a chance to troubleshoot that for a second. It was just a thought-provoking piece, and I wanted to just kind of call it out because I think it underscores something a lot of us Linux and open source enthusiasts have been talking about for a long time. I'll tell you about something else I've been talking about. That's Ting, my mobile service provider. Ting is mobile that makes sense. It's only pay for what you use wireless. It's your minutes, your messages, and your megabytes. They add them up, whatever bucket you fall into, that's all you pay. It's $6 for the line, a great control panel, really enthusiastic customer service, and really good selection of devices, too. All these are unlocked, so you own them outright. You can go to linux.ting.com.
Linux.ting.com. You know, Chris, I was doing the math yesterday, trying to get my parents to switch to Ting.
Mm.
I looked at the last year of their bill. They would save an average of $62 a month if they switched to Ting.
That's a nice
savings.
Yeah,
these are real-world figures. I did it yesterday.
Yeah, when you go to linux.ting.com, they have the savings calculator there on the front page.
Makes it really easy.
Yeah, you just plug it in there. And then, you know, so would they be getting more of a smartphone device or more of a feature phone device?
Well, this is on their current feature phone track. Mm. They're maybe not the most current people.
So they're cool with feature phones?
Yeah, and Ting works great with that. And, you know, they've been on another provider who... their phones will just work right with Ting. They won't have to change anything. Yeah.
Yeah, the feature phone prices are ridiculous. And then, of course, I love right here that you can get the Moto X second gen for $299 unlocked, the Moto Nexus 6, or you can get the LG 5X.
Right, when they're ready to go to that next level, Ting's got it all right there. You own the device outright.
It's nice, including my S6 Edge. So you can check them out at linux.ting.com. I love their customer service. I love the way their control panel works. It makes it really easy to manage my account. It's really easy also to pick between GSM and CDMA, so you can pick and choose which one's better in your area. And if you're a little savvy with Wi-Fi, it's going to blow your mind with the savings. Blow your mind. Check it out. Linux.ting.com. And a big thanks to Ting for sponsoring Linux Unplugged. Okay, Heavens, did you get your mic working? Did you get it fixed? Going once?
Yes, I believe I did.
All right. You're a little...
Testing.
Yeah, you're a little over... You're a little hot, but you're good. You're coming in now, so... what did you want to add on before
Sounds
we wrap
good.
Yeah, what did you want to add on before we wrap up?
You're really just applies to Apple's product, Apple software, or possibly the Apple hardware. So if we have a hardware module which we own ourselves, which they do not own, but their operating system APIs call, we could have our own owned decryption keys. Kind of like little, you know, key or whatever. Or the SIM card.
That would be nice. So, but it come down to the user owning the hardware and then just installing their OS on it.
They would use. And then it would bypass the EULA's agreement for us using their software or their OS.
That's an interesting idea.
That is interesting.
I wonder if that would ever actually happen.
Ever happen, yeah.
You know, so speaking of hardware, Xiaomi, I think is how you say it, they have been pondering a Linux laptop for a while, and now the folks over at OMG Ubuntu say... it's going to happen. Their long-rumored Linux laptop has been kicked around, and we've covered it once before in its earliest stage. It looks like it's going to be a 12.5-inch display and then another with a 13.7 3-inch display. The model with a 12.5-inch screen will be manufactured by Inventec, who also makes laptops for Acer and Toshiba and HP, with an initial order of 250,000 units. A slightly larger device is being made by Compella Electronics. They also supposedly manufacture some Apple devices and various PlayStation, Xbox, and Nintendo game consoles. And Yame is supposedly placing a 300,000 order unit with them. Hmm. Now, this would be shipping with their own version of Linux, they say.
Oh, interesting. Mm. Hopefully with not too much out-of-tree stuff.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And now we know no word even if it'd be shipping anywhere specifically. According to the same sources, they'll be priced cheaply but offer high performance.
I like that.
Just like the company's smartphones. So probably going to debut in China, I would imagine, but maybe eventually making it over here. Is anybody interested to see what Xiaomi could do? Actually, I don't think anybody in here was last time we talked about it. Has anybody changed their mind? No. Seems to be more popular online, though. We've gotten people sending to the show that are definitely looking forward to it.
I mean, I'm interested. I don't know that I would necessarily get one, but I feel like there's a couple, you know, 13, 14-inch laptops that people can look at. But really, they're like 90% of the laptop field is boring, 15-inch over, you know, it's like 5 pounds. It doesn't have a great resolution.
If you're coming into the laptop market today with a 12.5-inch or 13-inch laptop, you are probably targeting the MacBook Air, right?
Right.
And so then when you say that, I think light, thin, but decent performance.
Right.
But if you could just offer me a few things that the MacBook doesn't, like a couple more ports would be nice.
Better Linux compatibility.
Absolutely, that would be nice. Then maybe you got something here.
And it might be nice to invest, you know, maybe not, but it's nice to see clearly, you know, the Asus and Acers of the world, they have some stuff for us, but they're not really supporting our crowd very much. So
right.
we might be able to support a new right. company who will leverage that.
Yeah, System 76 has a laptop in this space. There's the Dell XPS. Then you can also go get yourself a ThinkPad. But
and maybe it'll be terrible. I don't know. But
there's still room here.
Interesting.
I think there is still room here for this. You put a really nice screen on there. You put a decent CPU in there, and maybe some PCI Express storage
at the right price point. Yeah,
I could be interested in that. I'm not really in the market right now. My XPS 13 does the job, but I could be interested in that. Yeah, I don't know. Anybody in the mumble room interested now? Anybody? Come on. I can't believe it. You guys, what do you got? You're all a bunch of ThinkPad users. No, you're just all a bunch of ThinkPad users.
The problem is, chances are it's going to only be available in China. Probably have some wacky version of Linux that doesn't contribute upstream at all.
Right.
And so if I wanted to wipe that and put something else like Ubuntu MATE or Ubuntu proper, I would probably find the wireless doesn't work or the touchpad skitty or whatever.
I agree.
And I don't want to have to buy something from China, find it doesn't work, and then end up putting it in a drawer or chucking it on eBay. I would rather know that it works, which is why I'm veering towards a ThinkPad or a Dell XPS.
So my question would be,
they contribute upstream.
My question would really be, is it going to be more Chromebook than it is Linux laptop?
Right.
And you know what I just kind of remembered, incidentally, is I believe my Librem 15 was supposed to arrive in September.
Oh.
It is now October.
We'll have to do some follow-up.
Remember how Remember how I backed that? I'm sure it's coming soon.
Yep.
I was told
Maybe
it was.
Maybe it's on the doorstep right now.
Maybe. It would still be late.
Yeah.
I would really like to do that. All right, Swift, you want to talk about ThinkPads? Go ahead.
Yeah, my thing about the whole ThinkPads thing is, while the recent ones, I keep hearing about the whole Superfish issue, the classic ones are really nice. The only thing I would say is the resolution is an issue. I'm currently in front of an X201 right now, and I love this machine.
Yeah, I think this is about what I hear all the time. That seems to be a pretty fair assessment. Wimpy, you have a Librem 13. Tell me, what do you think?
Well, I have the better version of the Librem 13 in that I actually have one that you can buy today and
right.
that works
yes.
and
yes.
is running stuff, yeah.
And so, do you like that hardware?
well, I do now that I've helped fix the touchpad driver in the Linux kernel.
Nice.
Yes, it works very nicely. But what's interesting about the Librem 13, I have some involvement with them. So, hello, everyone from Purism. You'll know me from the guy that sent you the kernel patches. But it's a long time coming, so they're just shipping the Librem 13, and Entraware, who I spoke about earlier, who have been shipping that hardware platform since almost the start of this year, have already revved on that platform and are just about to release their new version based on Skylake, and that's coming out in like next week or the week after.
That's going to be nice.
I just don't get this purism thing.
And this Xiaomi Linux laptop. I mean, I think this Xiaomi Linux laptop, or however you pronounce it, is a total non-story for actually any actual users.
Yeah.
I don't think it's going to be a product that we really get our hands on. And
Maybe not in the US, maybe not in Europe, but it could be a thing in China.
But even then, they won't even probably know it runs Linux.
Well, do they care?
No.
They just want something to replace Windows XP, don't they?
Yeah. Yeah.
Or a first computer. Not even necessarily something to replace XP. Yeah. There's a giant market of people who've never even owned a computer at all out in the burbs and beyond in China that have never had a computer.
Yeah.
And
yeah, absolutely. For them.
For those people, something like this that can get on the internet is a fantastic device.
Very much. I agree. I wait with anticipation for my Librem so I can give it a shot. I have been thinking it would be... Yikes. Did you hear that? There's a little voice.
How much did you pay for that?
I don't remember. It was during their crowdfunding. And I think over a year ago now. I can't remember.
Chris believed in it. He just gave it.
Maybe it wasn't
money.
A year ago. Maybe it was the beginning of the year. If I wasn't going to, a lot of times I will buy something specifically so I can have it for review on the show. And this is that does fall into the category of this, from a news standpoint, is an interesting topic, and it's really nice to be able to contribute some actual genuine observations on the product in the shows. So for me, that pushes it over the line. If I didn't have that, I don't think I'd push it over the line. But we'll see.
Fair enough.
We would only want to see.
I think the latest update from Crowd Supply said that the Librem 13 would ship in late October.
Yeah, but the 15. Any day now. The 15.
Oh, right. 15. If you order the 13. Mm. No, the 15 is October 19th, it says here.
Okay. So today is October 27th.
All I'll say is that the Librem is about three times over the price of where you can get it elsewhere.
Hmm.
And if you want...
Yeah, but you get hardware kill switches, though, Wimpy. And remember...
have you actually seen those? Oh,
well, we'll see. We'll see. The jury is out. We'll see.
Okay. Well, Chris, look. You know, if you want to review another hardware platform, then I know Entroware would be interested hooking you up with one of their new Skylake devices.
Oh, they should email me.
That sounds fun.
Yeah, I would not mind a Skylake device. That sounds cool. All right. I know my Quest. I feel like this quest for like a laptop that would be available in the stores. You walk in and that thing runs Linux. It's just we're so close, but yet so far away. Like, there's really great places now to go get good devices, like Entroware, System 76, and even Dell has Linux. Yeah. Right? Do they start shipping that again? I can't keep track of what they do with Linux.
But in theory, they will.
Okay. So there are, but you have to know. That's the thing. You have to know. Well, it's just
been a significant time investment figuring all that out.
You know what else you have to know? You ready for this, Wes? LinuxActionShow.reddit.com. That's where you go to give feedback to this show, or JupiterBroadcasting.com/contact. You can choose Linux Unplugged from the drop-down. We'd love to get your feedback.
Yes, we do.
Join us live, JBLive.tv. We do this show Tuesdays, JupiterBroadcasting.com/calendar. To get in your local time zone, it's 2 p.m. Pacific. Usually when we usually start a little bit before that, you know, just for funsies. Wes, anywhere you want people to check you out online?
Not this week, but there should be some stuff coming.
Mysterious.
Soon. Yes.
All right, follow the network at Jupiter Signal for live stream announcements and things like that. Linux Action Show on Sunday this week. Moving it to Sunday.
Oh, exciting.
This week to make room for some stuff. So check out Linux Action Show on Sunday instead of Friday. And see you right back here next week, everybody. All right, Wes, we're all done. We're out of here. We're done. Ooh, we're complete. Yes. Mission accomplished. JBtitles.com. Yes, it was. Thanks, everybody.
Fun. Thank you, everyone.
Sorry for being a grumpy old sod about Librem.
Chris. No, it's fine.
Sure,
it's good. Don't worry about it.
I'm sure you'll have fun reviewing the device.
Oh, well, we'll see. Okay. We'll see.
Linux communities survive on grump, so it's needed.
I think people have gotten a little too sensitive about criticism.
Yeah.
Just saying, there's people out there that get a little too sensitive about it. Sometimes criticism can be well-placed.
So criticize Chris as much as you want. He takes it very well.
Oh my God, don't they? Yep. Jeez, if there are people just criticize me constantly. They really do,
and that's how you got so good.
Yeah. Oh sure. Yeah.
And
thanks.
That's why you moved away from IRC. Why you moved away from Telegram?
Yeah. Yeah. Right. No kidding. No, that's not true. I'm in IRC all the time. But yeah, it is very true. And honestly, there's just tools to tune it out too if it gets ridiculous. That's really what it's about. There are plugins to just turn off comments when you don't want to see them, and there's all kinds of things you can do, but you just got to walk the line because you don't want to overdo it either. JBtitles.com. Well, JBtitles.com.
I wasn't trying to enroll myself into your twit filter. I was just trying to provide some level headed. I suppose I'm just forewarning you. Yeah. Oh, man.
It's a little bit of a bummer.
What can I say?
It's a bit of a bummer. Well, and you know what else is...
If you had paid for the Librem 13, what you can get for it elsewhere, what you pay for it elsewhere, it's a good machine. But it's like three times more expensive through Librem, and they're trying to pitch this as like an Apple-type product, and it just isn't that. So
yeah, it's well, fundamentally, how does a brand new company compete with a 30-year-old company at manufacturing? How do you even do that fundamentally? Yeah. Even if it's
and the other thing is that Purism have tried to pitch that they're doing all of this manufacturing themselves, and that's not the case either. So it's a little bit smoke and mirrors.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So Chris, can I criticize you for being so negative on the Xiaomi laptop?
Sure. Yeah, that's fine. Yeah, you think it has a good chance of becoming big?
Well, I won't make any prophecy, but this company has been doing great phones, and it seems like they really have a great price to performance ratio. And also their devices are always very well thought out, and they are also a very big manufacturer of phones. So I think they have quite some experience, and I was actually hopeful that they might shake up things a little bit.
Well, you should have said that in the show. That's a good, I hope. I agree. I think probably if you could, what I would criticize our takeaway on it is it could be big for thousands and thousands of people, but just not for us. Right. I mean, that's
we're jaded Americans.
Yeah.
The problem is getting into the U.S. market, I think, for a lot of these products.
Not really. The Chinese market is gigantic. We get this in Ubuntu. We get like, when is it coming to the US? When is it coming to the US? And there's like 300 million people in the US or whatever your population is. But there's a shit ton of people over in China as well.
Mm-hmm.
And those people are people who are actually buying devices who don't currently have a device or don't currently have a laptop. And so there's a gigantic untapped market over that side of the
planet.
And
that middle class over there is expanding. There's a lot of growth potential over there right now.
Yeah, when Apple's profits in just China dwarf Samsung and Motorola and LG and everybody else combined, that's a big market.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, also China has 1/7 of the world's population, so...
Yeah, and so it could be...
I'm really
be,
excited for my Chinese MacBook Air.
Yeah, so exactly. It could be a Chinese MacBook Air, exactly. And it could eventually make its way over.
Exactly like a MacBook Air.
Well, that picture might literally be a MacBook Air. I don't know.
Yeah. Well, I'm curious if...
Yeah, that's the funny thing.
I saw a comment before. It was really funny in IRC. I saw a comment that said that they could just ship from China a MacBook that has an Apple logo that it just runs elementary OS. Yeah. I thought that was funny.
But I'm bummed. What's new, mate?
I have been looking at new phones, looking at alternative devices are there out there, and the Xiaomi phones look really nice. They've got some nice mid to high range, high end. Like you're talking like 3 gig of RAM rather than 2.
They look okay.
With 4G chipsets and decent resolution screen and multiple SIM slots and all that kind of stuff for a really decent price point, like $180 or something like that.
Yeah, I know.
But you have to get rid of the software. I've used one, and the Chinese software on there, oh man.
Yeah. Right, probably wipe it and put Cyanogen or something else on there. But I'd do that
anyway. So.
It almost reminds me of that Windows firmware thing with the... I don't know that it was the Windows... Something with the BIOS or something like that with the firmware, that something was in there. I heard it on a previous show. I don't know if it was Linux Action Show or Linux Unplugged or something like that. But I heard about Windows loading something onto your... Oh yes, it was for the OEM the OEM laptops where the manufacturer or someone could put special firmware on your device. So whenever you installed Windows if you reinstall Windows, it would automatically install those applications again.
Yeah.
It kind of reminds me of that.
Yeah, Lenovo's. Yeah.
Again.
I think we should go with what's new, Mate, or Mate.
Yeah, that sounds good to me.
I think I like it. And it was a good conversation. So thank you, Wimpy, for making it in here on the... And thank you, Poppy, for picking Wimpy.
Yes. No, thank you. You're welcome. Thank you very much. Yeah, I'm just Poppy's bitch. He
he summoned you.
Come running.
Yeah. We were going to sick... Well, it was either that or sick the whole chat room on you, and so we figured that was probably more
efficient, if anything.
Well, yeah. So thank you for making it. And thank you guys for being here. And so chat room, don't forget, I mentioned it right there at the end of the show, but we're going to do Linux Action Show on Sunday. Probably 10 a.m. our regular time. Yeah. So. Okay. All right. Bye, Mumble Room. Thank you for being here.
When do you change your clocks? Is it Saturday night, Sunday morning? So your
JB is going to move. Oh, my God. Is that a thing? Oh, could I possibly?
Yes. You change this weekend.
Oh, why did I have to?
Yeah, it's like Sunday morning.
On the one day we move back to Sunday. Oh my God! Oh my God! Oh my God! This is horrible. That could not have gone more worse.
Just set it back an hour. You've done.
Yeah.
That is horrible. Oh jeez.
Just do it early on Saturday.
And you know what? You know what makes it even more complicated is Noah is traveling across time zones right now. He will be traveling while we're doing the show across time zones.
Oh, that's gonna be a disaster.
Holy crap!